Hi, everyone. Let's get started. Thanks, everyone, for coming today afternoon. Just a quick introduction. I'm Shelley. I'm with the IAB Tech Lab. I look after all the ad products, so all the ad formats and other related standards like safe frames, the new ad portfolio, as well as I look after the mobile, which is MRAID, and our tools like the mobile MRAID SDK tester and other tools that we have in beta right now, like the HTML5 ad validator. So coming on to today's topic, which is working with HTML5 ads. So this event is a platform's showcase where we basically invite companies who build platforms that help you build HTML5 ads, and they do a very hands-on demo to walk you through the different features and show the capabilities of what's possible with HTML5 and how their platforms enable you to build great HTML5 ads. The reason we started with this was way last year when Google announced the Chrome 48 updates, which would limit Flash capabilities, and everybody wanted alternatives to Flash platform for HTML5 development. The reason behind this was to educate that there are a lot of platforms which allow you to build HTML5 ads in a drag and drop, see what you get way that was possible with Flash platforms. So we start with a losing sound. Okay. So we started these are the three events that we have done so far in educating the market on HTML5. The first one was a webinar, which was on September 1 last year, the day Chrome 48 was released, to educate on how you can transition to HTML5 ads and the top five things that you need to care about. And then the feedback that we got from the market was that there needs to be more education, because a lot of the people in the industry are designers and not necessarily web developers, and they need to be educated on what it takes to build a good HTML5 ad. So the second event was more ABCDs of HTML5 ads, which focused on, it was again a hands-on demo here in New York, which focused on how to build, optimize, and package HTML5 ads for good delivery. And there was an additional session by Google's Chrome team on what performance on the web means and how HTML5 ads interact with the web performance and what are the factors that go into high performance of the page as well as the ad. And then the next series event in this series was what we did in San Francisco in April, where we had Jevox, Seltra, SponsCell, and Flexitive present. That's where we started the platform showcase, where these companies presented their platforms, which was pretty well received, and we got a feedback of doing more and interest from a lot more companies to showcase their platforms. So which brings us to today's session. So in today's session, we have these five themes that the companies today would be showcasing through their platforms. The first one is scaling cross-device responsive ad creatives. The second one is cross-screen buying in programmatic environments, how you can build creatives that you can use to buy cross-screen buys. The third one is building dynamic creatives using data feeds. And then creating engaging content with HTML5, different types of interactions that you can create, and then how platforms allow you to build ads and focus on building the ad and not worry about cross-platform testing, and they take care of all of that code in the back end. So with that, I won't take more of your time. I just want to introduce all the speakers today, and then we'll just jump right into the demos. We have Matthew Snyder from Responsive Ads, who's right at the back there. He's the co-founder of Responsive Ads. From Flash Talking, we have Sam. He's the director of mobile creative technologies at Flash Talking. And from Google web designer team, we have Nivesh. He's a senior web developer on the Google web designer team. And from Seismic, we have Katie Hausman, will be presenting along with Mike McNulty. Katie is the team lead for the solution engineers at Seismic. And then I already introduced myself, I'm Shelley. And then I want to thank Mina and Colleen, who've helped us with organizing the event, marketing, and sending you all emails and reminders to come here. So with that, we'll just jump right into the demos. we'll start with Google. We'll just go clockwise, Google, Seismic, Flash Talking, and end with responsive ads. So it'll just take a minute for us to switch over some standard operating procedures to switch. We'll just do that.
So this is an overall like platform event, but I'm going to be focusing on Google Web Designer. It's a design tool for creative professionals, and this fits in really well with all our other platform offerings as well. But this is a tool that is actually created using HTML. It outputs HTML5, and everybody knows now why we need to have HTML5, obviously, right? Flash is dead. It's not on mobile. We've got to help users create content that reach all our audiences in across different devices. So this tool is free, and you can download it from our website here, Google Web Designer. It's google.com/webdesigner. It's available for Mac and Win and for Linux. I also recommend you guys go down to the bottom here. There's a Help Center, community forum, YouTube channel has tons of examples and tutorials, even from the user community as well. And you can also get a certification through Google. So there's also a showcase. You can see some of the example ads that have been created here. And you can also go to the double-click rich media gallery and sort by Google Web Designer and the filters here, and which I've already done. You can see some of the ads. These are like award-winning ads. For example, this Narcos ad, this one, I'm not sure exactly. They've been winning tons of awards. But you can make dynamic ads with this. Here's an example of a dynamic ad that was created using the tool. Here's a user in Rome during the day, sunny weather. User in Naples, rainy weather. This is dynamic feed, but in the background, the layout and the interactivity is done using Google Web Designer. I'll show you how easy it is to do that. So let me give you a brief history of the tool. So we launched the beta in September 2013. We've had major releases pretty much every quarter, 4 million downloads, billions of impressions every, on the different display networks. And for this demo, I'm going to focus on creating engaging content, content that scales across devices and also are dynamic. So let's go ahead and get to it. And if we have time, I'll show you guys some other like animation and interactivity capabilities. For now, I'm just going to go ahead and create this ad here that is basically you have two cars and a logo. And as you get smaller, one of the cars disappears. And if I'm viewing this on an even smaller device or ad size, it goes to a vertical layout. There's not enough space. The ad adjusts, and I can also add animation. There's the cars sliding in. I can show the ad. And now in this case, it's the dynamic component of this is I've added a call to action button, and if I click on it, this one I had picked the San Francisco feed, so it shows me the different dealerships in San Francisco. And if I go to, let's say I pick a New York feed, and let's say I click on the New York one, it'll take me to the different dealers in New York. And I'll show you how easy it is to wire that up. So let's go back to the tool. You'll see it's a lot like other design tools. There's tools over here, tool options. There's a properties panel, which lets you set different styles and attributes. And today, I'm going to be talking about how to use the tools and the responsive panel, and the dynamic panel, and the viewport resize tool to create this layout. So I've already added my content to this file. This is saved on some clicking. And you can see there's a library that you can see the different assets I have here. Okay. And So let's go ahead and see this. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to select all the elements here, and I'm going to click Align to Container. And what that does is it says, oh man, the mic finally kicked in, sorry. Okay, and what that does is it makes sure that the alignments that I pick here from the Align tool, Align options, is relative to the parent container. If I select the Fluid option, what this does is that it will make sure that even if the container changes, they'll respect those alignments. So let me go ahead and select those, and I'm going to align their vertical center, and I'm also going to space them evenly horizontally. So now I'm going to switch to the viewport resize tool. I'll be talking about this tool more later. And now if I am, let me turn off the layout, the guides. And let me go ahead and resize here. So you can see, as I'm doing this, it's adjusting with the, it stays centered vertically, and it respects the ratio that it was around the parent container. Now, when we get to, you know, about a little bit closer here, it's starting to get kind of congested. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the responsive panel to use media queries to actually change my layout. And media queries is, you know, just a HTML5 or just HTML feature that lets you create different styles for when the, there are different attributes, but for us, we've been focusing on just the different size. And what this will do is it'll allow you to apply different styles to different elements based on the size of your screen or the size of your ad slot. Okay. So I'm going to go to Media Rules panel, and I'm going to add a width breakpoint. Okay. And now I can adjust where I want the range to be using the scrubber over here on the ruler, or I can directly type in a value here. So at this point, what I've done is I've created two rules, two ranges. One is from 0 to 600, and one is from 600 and greater. And when it's at this, and I can switch between the styles I'm editing based by just clicking over here between the different breakpoints. And the panels are color-coded. You can see the ranges here. It's orange. There's an orange one here. There's pink over here. And the, whichever one is currently active is also has a wider bar next to it. So I'm going to go ahead and change the layout for this size. And I'm simply going to select the element. I'm going to set its style. Visibility hidden, and I can just move this out of the way because it doesn't matter because these are also just style attributes. I'm changing left, top, width, height, or transform properties. I'm going to bring back my outline mode. I'm going to select all of these, and I'm going to reapply my actually, let me show you what it looks like behind the scenes. If I go to code view, I can see that my content is just HTML, CSS content. You know, you can. What we did when we created the media queries is I created two media rules here. One for the greater than 600, there's no content yet. I haven't overridden any styles. And one for the range that goes up to 600. And in this case, I basically just hidden the element and I changed its you know, translation property by moving it off screen a little bit. So, and you can actually, you know, it's completely editable, human readable. But let me go back to design view. And now I'm going to reapply the layout. I'm going to do the same thing, space them evenly horizontally. Now if I do, if I use the viewport tool and I can see that there's only one car, one logo. When it gets bigger, there's two cars. And I can do, you know, more. Like let's say I'm over here and around maybe 400 and maybe 420. I actually want to switch the layout even further. So let's say I'm over here, I want to, it's kind of getting bunched up here. So I'm just going to go ahead and select these again. I'm going to relay them out like this. And once again, I'm going to just select them all. And this time I'm going to do a vertical layout. I'm going to go ahead and arrange them, their horizontal centers. I'm going to space them evenly vertically. Now you can see that, let me go ahead and turn off the outline modes again so you guys can see the, just what the content would look like. Okay. Now, at this range, it's a vertical layout, switch to horizontal layout, and switch even more to have the other car come in. And so there's ads. For most web content, you're fine with this width breakpoints. But for ads, they have so many different sizes and aspect ratios. We have two things. One is you can use portrait landscape orientation. But for now, I'd like to show you something else. It's creating height breakpoints. And so let's say I'm around here, 300. And now it looks like I actually have space for that other car. I'm going to add a height breakpoint. And once again, it's color-coded. There's a lower range that's green. That's a higher range that's green, and the lower range that's blue. And let me say around 300, I'm actually going to bring back that car that we hit earlier. So let me go back to the, so I can see the hidden elements. And I'm going to unhide this. And you can see over here in the properties panel, any properties styles that I've overridden are actually highlighted in this orange color. So if I click on it, I can choose to remove that override. So the master, the base styles apply to it. So let me go ahead and move this down. And just redo the same type of layout. You know, let's center this and space them evenly again. So now we have, let's see, turn off the outlines. And if I use the viewport resize tool, I can see what it looks like, the different sizes. And I can also, you know, there's common ad sizes and device sizes over here. So I can go ahead and select 720x890. If I'm using specific device sizes, let's say I can also go ahead and flip the orientation so I can see what it would look like in different devices. So now that we've done this, let me go ahead and add the animation aspect of it. So since I am just using media rules, and Google Web Designer outputs CSS3 animations, those are the styles as well. So we can go ahead and easily encode these style changes for animations using media rules also. So let me go ahead and show you how easy it is to add the animations. So let's say when I'm over here, I want the cars to drive in. So I'm just going to, this is the quick mode animation. I'm going to go ahead and just add a thumbnail. And this has created a default animation of 0.5 seconds. What I'm going to do is I'm actually going to have the cars, I'm going to select them, and I'm going to move them off screen. And I can use shift modifier to maintain my, you know, just the constraint to move horizontally. These are all things that designers are very used to. So now if I go back and select them at the other keyframe, move them back in, and that's all I have to do to create an animation. So I can preview it on stage here. That happened a little bit fast. So let me go ahead and change the timing. I can change the timing here, switch it to 1 second. I can also change the easing to ease so that now I can see it took a little longer, it eased in. And I can switch to advanced mode, and I can see, you know, like this is like a lot of other timelines. You can use, you can do keyframes, you can move the spans, various things like that. There's lots of tutorials. I encourage you guys to check it out. But for now, let me just show you that. Just like the styles that we overrode, the visibility, over here, the animation is also just a style. And you can see that I've overridden the animation because this is, for these two cars, it's orange. So if I click on it, I can also remove that override if I wanted to. Similarly, I can go ahead and create additional animations for the different, and here, let me show you how to do it in advanced mode. I'm going to insert a keyframe, and once again, I'm just going to move this guy off screen on the, let me go ahead and undo. On the first keyframe, I'm going to make it off screen. And in the 1 second, I'm going to have it come back into the screen. And again, I can preview. So this one has just the one animation, and I'm going to go ahead and add the easing on this one also. And of course, I could also do custom easing if I wanted to, and so I can scrub the animation here. Okay. And so now I have two different animations, right? I created the animation where I have two cars coming in. And if I, now I also have the animation for the one car coming in. And those are all just simply styles overrides. So let me go ahead and, I could go through the mechanics of adding the animations for all the different ones. I don't know. Let me go ahead and just open one that's already been, you know what, actually, let me just go ahead and really quickly do this one. Okay. Keyframe, same stuff, right? Just moving the car out of the way and moving the car back in. Okay. Ease. Okay. So now I've added the animation to are the top ones. Let's say I don't want to add an animation for the bottom one. I could just as easily add it for the bottom one too. Okay. Now for the, let me go ahead and preview this. I can preview for different browsers here. I can preview for whatever browser is installed on my system. Right now I have, it's a Mac, so I have Chrome, Firefox, and Safari. I'm previewing in Chrome, and I can see the animations right here. And one of the things was I had the wheels moving in that previous demo. So let me go ahead and show you how easy it is to do that. And in this case, I'm going to create an animation that works across all the rules. And for that, I'm going to go back to the responsive panel and switch the master rules. And I don't know if you guys noticed this, but the cars themselves are made up of different assets. So I can double-click to go inside the asset, and there's the car, the image. But there's also these wheels that, that were added. And these wheels are reusable assets. So they're called groups in Google Web Designer. And I'm going to go ahead and add an animation to one of those, to the definition of it, and then it will just apply to all the other wheels on all the other cars. So let me switch to the library panel. I will pick my this wheel here. I'll say edit. So now I'm going to do a similar animation. I'm going to have 1 second, and I'm going to have it rotate in reverse clockwise 360 times two, and I'm going to go ahead and add the using for this one too, so it matches up with the cars. Now if I go back to, and I can use the breadcrumb to go back to my main timeline. Now if I preview the animation, you can see that the car's moving too. And actually now let me show you the responsive ones. So now if I'm in the responsive one, I can see the animation comes in like that. And all the, and it's synced across the other media rules as well. Since I made the, it was a base animation, it applies to this one as well. And let's preview that again. So there it is. So it's that easy. And so for the dynamic aspect, I want to show you it's just as easy to do dynamic in the tool. Let me switch to the master rules, and let me, because I want this to apply to everything. And let me go ahead and add a component. We have built-in components for very common workflows. I think you guys are used to things like videos, YouTube components, you know, carousel galleries. For this one, I'm just going to use this tap area component. It's like a, creates a hotspot, and it has the events for both mobile and web, you know, click and touch. So I'm going to align this to the stage again, and I'm just going to go ahead and use the properties panel. And I'm going to set this to also grow with the stage at 100%. I'm just going to cover up the entire stage with this, because this is going to be an invisible button. When the user clicks on it, I'm going to add some event that will you know, forward them to my exit URL. So let me go ahead and give it an ID. I can give an ID here, exit button. And I'm going to go to the dynamic panel here. And for this one, I'm using, I've created an AdWords ad. I can show you guys how to switch between different environments. You can also create a non-Google ad, just a generic ad. Over here, I'm going to just, for AdWords, we try to centralize it around some common schema for various verticals. And for here, I'm just going to select sample retail, and I can select, I can bind different elements, different properties on the different elements to stuff from my data feed. In this case, it's a sample retail data feed. And over here, I'm going to find my tap area exit button. I'm going to bind it various properties. I can bind, you know, style attributes like color, opacity. I'm going to bind the exit override URL. And from the data schema, we have presets for commonly used values, but I can also drill down to specific things I want from my schema. So for example, the sample retail one has different products, but let me go ahead and just bind to the CTA here. And save it and publish. Okay, now when I did that, you'll see that there's a little combo box here to preview. And right now I just have generic feed. They don't really have any data, so let me, you can also use your own feed. So I've actually created these sample feeds based on that. And let me go ahead and copy it into the feeds folder. You can add your own feeds from your whatever ad network you're using. So let me go ahead and republish. And now I can see that my sample feeds are here. I'm going to pick the New York feed. And now my tap area, when I click on it, will use the feed that I have specified. With the, it has the New York assets in it. So now I'm going to the New York for a New York audience. Now, if I go to the San Francisco feed, San Francisco. That's pretty much how to create a responsive content. I can show you some other really cool things. Like I mentioned, you know, when I did the 720 degrees there, I can also do 3D as well. So for example, here's an example with 3D. So, and this one is tracking, this is, I laid out the assets in 3D. This actually is another engineer, Patrick Volker, created this. And this is also interactive. I can click on this button here. And the YouTube content plays. I can, you know, go to the map. There are some other examples I want to show you guys really quickly. Here's using advanced mode, you know, and just like four images, I can do a parallax, just moving one background, looping the background over and over, having one, the one in the front move faster than the one in the back, and you can see what that looks like. This is a Steinbeck Google Doodle. I just took the assets and recreated it using Google Web Designer. There are some, here's an example, another engineer on our team created, Nicola, and this is an example of just showing you how you can make, you know, I just created some dummy, you know, I'm using our dummy assets, the cars always, we're always using those cars. But here's one, you know, like maybe something with, and you can see like how it adapts based on he's hiding elements as it gets larger and smaller. You want to focus on the content that's inside here because that's what you would see in the browser. And if I were to switch to code view, you can see that, you know, like each media override is about 10, maybe 15 lines of code. Basically, you've created so many, an ad that would fit so many different sizes for just a 15 lines of text. And text compresses really well. So if I were to go to publish this, I can see, you know, it's compressed, the initial load size is only 14K. And this is utilizing, you know, CSS, compresses really well, doing media queries, and it makes it really easy to sync up assets. I can replace these assets and you know, like the styles can remain. It's very much a designer-centric tool. But again, code is something developers will hopefully not, you know, get scared by. It looks, it's, we've strived really hard to make sure the code itself is also clean and very easy to use. Yeah.
I have a question.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Kanya. I'm from Disney ABC. I'm a digital ad trafficker. So my question is, that's the perfect ad. Earlier you clicked on it and there was a drop-down menu and you could select between New York or different cities.
Right.
Would that be on the actual ad or is that part of the code? So when on the page, I don't know if it's reading the IP address and stuff like that and figuring out like where to take you to show you the dealerships, is that what that would do?
So for this tool, we have integrated so far with AdWords, the dynamic schemas, and also DoubleClick. But I don't know if all the – you have to check with the account managers to see if you have permission to use the dynamic feeds. So in this case, let me go ahead and open the file that I was – the different feeds. So the feed that we were looking at was – I took the dummy feed that we have for just special help, and I actually just went ahead and duplicated some of the assets here. So let me see. So this is the feed, like I can go to AdWords and I can see, hey, what is the feed that you would send to, you know, when an ad is loading? Your ad gets loaded in a iframe and then there's like something else that says, hey, this is a specific type of user at this geolocation, send them this data to that ad. So in this case, just for testing, we have some dummy feeds and you can edit those by hand. So over here I went and I just changed, I think I just went and changed, maybe that's not in New York, but San Francisco. Yeah, so I went ahead and changed the headline text. And this is something that you would go onto your feed and change, but I don't want to, like, I wanted this to be a tool-specific demo, so I'm not even going to go into AdWords or DoubleClick Studio to try to show you how that works. I'm not very good at it myself. But this is the stuff that your ad network would provide to the creative. And the creative, based on the schema, when you have that data, we can tell. We look at the JSON data structure and we say, oh, hey, it has so many products, it has headlines. That was what I was binding to earlier here. Let's see. So in the data schema here, we analyze that JSON object and we can tell what kind of things I can bind to. In this case, for the design aspects, you can bind to backgrounds, all these things, and these are from the AdWords one. you can bind to different, you know, prices, all sorts of stuff. And you can bind on a per product info. In fact, let me see if I have, here's an example. Oh, okay, here's one that has more content. So you can, and it's really just like picking the element on stage that you want. You can filter by the current scene, the current page, or the selection that you have. You can bind their different attributes, like background color, text content, things like that. And then you can bind to the different feeds. And in this case, let's see. Here's the dummy feed we ship with, and then you can just test out your layout. And then, like, here's another dummy feed. And these all have different data, but the data has the same schema. So you can, so if you make a binding using our tool, it knows that, hey, I'm just going to replace this data with this other data. They're different texts, but they have the same format. Like this one's going to be text, this one's going to be numbers, like that.
I'm Greg Grittman at AOL. For advertising, we find a lot of times that people want to use sort of these extra libraries. You know, they might want to use a tweening library,
right.
Or frameworks. Is there a way to get those into the application?
Yes, definitely. Really easy. We actually want to make it even easier. So, for example, if I go to CodeView here, you can see that our components are already we have some extra additional libraries for Google, like the DoubleClick enabler and such. You can actually just add a link to your, you know, Green Sock, for example. Let me show you how easy it is to do that. Create a new, I don't know. Let me just add a dummy div with some color. Again, rich colored code too. I can do gradient such like that. So let me go ahead and give it an ID. Click me, and if I go ahead and let me see if the we can find the double click Green Sock CDN. Okay, so here are some hosted libraries I know of from and I can just pick, for example, Green Sock, and let's say I want to copy this tween light. I would just include this as a script tag directly in CodeView. We want to actually make it easier for designers as well, so I can go to script tag here, go ahead and add another script. And that's it. Now I can use this if I were to go here and say, are you familiar with the APIs? Because I'm not, but let me go ahead and create an event. And I could just say, hey, on mouse click, I want to add some custom code. And I would give it a name, animate. And I'd have to look at the Green Sock API, but let's see. It has how easy it is to do some animations. And I could just go ahead and copy and paste this here, maybe. Greenlight dot. Okay. And my thing was called Click Me, I think. And let's preview that. Oh, let's see. Click Me. I can look at the events panel. Logo, I set it on the wrong thing. This should work. Let me say I want to change the, let's change this. Maybe it couldn't override the gradient. Say, why not? Okay. But anyway, you should be able to do this. Let me see if I actually have some examples here.
That's okay. You didn't.
Okay, but it should be that easy, yeah. Okay. You know, actually, we have tutorials on how to use external libraries. I would go there, yeah.
So I'll just do the
quick switch.
Yeah, who done it kind of?
Let me take that off for you. So we'll be invite Seismic to present their demo. We'll have time for questions at the end.
Hi, everyone. I'm Katie with Seismic, and I'm here to show you guys Seismic's HTML5 ad builder. So I'm actually going to go ahead and jump right in and show you what we're going to be building today. Our ad builder can be used to build ads from the very complex to the very simple, but we're going to be building something that is a little bit more middle of the road. It looks pretty simple for the sake of time, but it does have some slightly more complex elements to it. We have this ad that is dynamic, and this one is scaling responsive. Our platform does also support responsive design via breakpoints, but we're going to go ahead and show you how to do the scaling responsive today. The dynamic elements would be the product here and on the collapse panel, as well as this line of text. So essentially, there are three dynamic elements. Real quickly, if we switch to this other version of the ad, you'll see a different product flying in there, and this line of text is different. So that's what we're going to be showing you how to do today. At the end of the demo, I'll show you guys some more complex ads that people have built using our tool as well. Before we jump into building, real quick, I thought I would show you how easy it is to actually map dynamic elements from a feed or from other sources to the dynamic elements that are in the ad, just because it's really quick and easy to do. So I actually have our ad open already, the settings for the ad from our platform, and I'm going to go to the Smart Versioning tab, which is our name essentially for dynamic creative. And here we have a feed that is being pulled in through our platform. And it's a small feed, there's only a couple versions, but it is pulling in different banner images, different panel images, and different text. And to set this up is really, really simple. All we had to do was click on feed and then click on subscribe to data feed. And here, this is already filled in because obviously we already have the ad set up. But if you didn't, all you would have to do is paste your URL for your feed in here, click on Get Data, and then from there, it's really just a couple of clicks to assign the rest of the information. Essentially, you're going to be clicking on Add Value and choose what you want to map from the feed to what dynamic element is in the ad. And you guys will see me create these dynamic elements in just a couple minutes. From there, once you have your elements mapped, all you have to do is click on Save and Import, and it will go ahead and import your data. And that is how we imported the data from the feed to the dynamic ad. We're not going to get into this today, too, but it's worth mentioning that you can also create dynamic ads manually in the platform one by one, which is great if you just need to add a version real quick or make a simple modification. And you can also export and then import an Excel file to create tons of versions, actually hundreds of thousands of versions, very, very quickly in our platform, too, if you don't want to use a feed or you can't use a feed for some reason. But we are here today to actually see how to build the ad, so I'm going to go ahead and show you guys how to do that. So our ad builder tool is integrated directly within our platform. There's many different ways to access it, but right on the home screen, you can click on Ad Builder, and it takes you here to our welcome screen. There are a few different templates, or you can create a blank ad from scratch. We're going to be creating a blank ad, but I do want to show you real quick that we have a lot of templates available as well. So we have a lot of basic templates, things like polite banners, some basic expandables, adaptive banners. These would be some of the banners with breakpoint responsiveness that we have for different ad size, which is really great for creating ads cross-screen. We have some other more rich media type formats like pushdowns, billboards, interstitials, and adhesion formats. And we're actually adding new formats all the time. So I wouldn't be surprised to see more stuff added to this very soon. In addition, you can also save your own templates. So if we go to the My Templates format or section over here, we have a lot of templates that people have created. So if you need to create a template that other people in your account may need to use or repurpose in the future, you can do that. You don't have to start from one of our templates. But we're going to create a blank ad, and I'm going to go ahead and just call this IAB Demo, Seismic. Choose the format. So as you guys saw, we built a pretty simple expandable ad, so that's what we're going to go ahead and select here. We're going to choose the dimensions, which in this case are 300 by 250, and the panel dimensions. This is basically what the panel is starting at. So my assets are actually sized for a 728 by 300 expandable panel, but as you saw, we're going to be making that panel responsive anyway. Go ahead and click Create, and here is our stage. So real quick before I jump into building, a very quick overview of the UI. On the left over here, we can navigate between the collapsed portion of the ad and the different panels. As I start building, you'll also see the different components on the stage showing up here in kind of like a layered list, which you can, you know, rearrange, show, hide, that sort of thing. On the right side, we have a contextual properties menu as well as a contextual actions and animations menu. You guys will see me using that soon. And we also have a components menu, and this is how we add things to our ad. You can show and hide these if you want. You can move these around. And then up here, we have some alignment options that you guys will see me using as I build. So what I'm going to go ahead and do is start building this ad and show you guys how quick it is to actually build a fairly fully functional ad with two different components. So if you guys remember from the preview of the ad, we've got a logo, we've got the product image, and then we had like a little CTA, like a tap click to expand at the bottom there. So I've added an image component to the stage just by clicking on it. And now we can double click to load an image. You can upload all of your assets to the asset library, or you can upload one asset at a time from your computer. I'm going to go ahead and upload all of my assets real quick so that I only have to go through that upload process once. So we'll go ahead and go to my computer and choose all of the assets that we're going to need. Oh, actually, here I can only upload one at a time. So we'll go ahead and do the logo. Select, and there it is on the stage. Real quick, we'll go ahead and upload the rest of our assets too. And that's uploading. It'll continue to upload in the background, so I can just click done. So we've got our logo here. I'm going to go ahead and add the product image to the stage. I'm going to move kind of quickly through that because you guys already saw how to add one. This image is rather large, so I obviously am going to need to resize that. So we'll bump it down. And we'll go ahead and do a quick center align on that. So I'm going to center that, and we'll put that up towards the top there and center align that as well. You can see over on the left here, my layers are showing up. If I want to have better control or, you know, be able to see what I'm looking at with just a glance, I can rename those. So we'll go ahead and call this banner product, and you can now see that corresponds over here on the left. So I've added my images. I'm going to go ahead and create that black bar that was across the bottom. That's really easy using our shape component. You can manually resize this if you want. I happen to know that I want this to be a 300 by 50. And I'm going to go ahead and quickly align that to the bottom of the stage here. And I am going to make it black. Next up, we want to add our CTA text. So that's just going to be the text component. And we'll just make this say tap or click to expand. Pretty quick there. I'm going to go ahead and change the font to white because we want to be able to see it on the black background. You have all the normal options in text editing here, font size, the actual font, the weight of the font, the alignment. We'll go ahead and center that. Line spacing, and you can actually add custom fonts too. So you can either upload a font from your computer or you can paste a font embed code there as well. But for the sake of time, I'm just going to go ahead and leave it as is. And we'll go ahead and center that as well down there at the bottom. So the only thing missing before we move on to the panel is a hotspot. Right now, if we tapped or clicked on this ad, nothing would happen. We haven't actually told this ad that we want it to expand yet. I'm going to go ahead and do that by adding a hotspot. It's worth noting that you can actually do this without a hotspot if you just want like one element that is in the ad to be clickable. You can apply the expand feature directly to an object, but since I want this entire thing to be clickable to expand, I'm just going to do that quickly with the hotspot. And now all I need to do is tell this hotspot what I want to do. It's just a couple clicks. Create new event, tap click. So when hotspot one is tapped or clicked, we want it to expand, and I'm actually going to choose expand to full screen because that's part of what makes that other panel scaling responsive. And I need to tell it what I want to expand, so that's panel one, and that's it. So we've already built the collapse portion. We haven't added any animation. I'll show you guys how to do that towards the end, but let's move on and quickly build this panel as well. So this had a product image, a logo, the dynamic text field, a CTA on the bottom. So we'll go ahead and start with the video that was in the top right. So video component quickly adds this to the stage. I can resize this. So we'll just do like 400 by 250. Again, I'm just going to go ahead and align this to the top right. You have some of your expected options here to set the video to publisher specs, like whether or not you want it to start muted, whether or not you want it to autoplay, show a control bar, that sort of thing. I'm just going to leave this the way it is for now. What concerns us is the poster and the video files. Poster file is what shows when the video is not playing. We have one of those, so we'll go ahead and select that real quick. And then we'll select the video file that I uploaded at the beginning when I uploaded all those assets. And now we actually have a fully functioning video in here already. Moving on, we'll add those images in real quick to the left. I'm going to move through that pretty quickly because, again, you guys have seen this a couple times now. So that's going to be the logo there, the product image that, again, we're going to want to resize because that is pretty large. We'll go ahead and just quickly move that over here. Below that, we had a line of dynamic text. So I'm going to go ahead and just say this will become dynamic. And we'll go ahead and center align this and rearrange that down here. This isn't dynamic yet, but in just a minute, I'll show you guys how to make that dynamic. Lastly, we're going to add another shape to the bottom. And we want this to be black, just like before, so that it has a more cohesive look and feel. Move that towards the bottom. And then finally, we'll add some CTA text. So we'll say, find out more. Make it white so it shows up. And can move that down here. before I show you guys animations and how to make things dynamic, I do want to point out that we have a lot of social integrations over here on the left-hand side, some other components that you can use. I'm not going to get into all of them for the sake of time, but you can see we do have some share to Facebook and Twitter components. You can pull in a Twitter feed or a Facebook feed, pin to Pinterest. We have a fully functional media gallery where you can add images, video, that sort of thing. But for the sake of time, we'll go ahead and skip over those. I am going to add a hotspot to this entire ad as well, because again, we want this to be clickable. Right now, if we were to click on this, it wouldn't actually do anything. So again, hotspot, I'm gonna just quickly make this the right dimensions here and move it into place. Again, we're gonna create a new event on tap or click. We want it to trigger the click-through. And this will be the default click-through that you can either set in the platform, or if you have like a feed that you're pulling in information in, you could map the URLs from the feed to your different versions as well, which will be pulled in automatically. The last step in making this actually responsive is just to make sure we have that responsive panel checked. And from here, we have actually a fully functioning ad. There's no animation and there are no dynamic elements yet, but we've built the ad very, very quickly. To make things dynamic in this ad is very, very simple. For our ad builder, all we want to do is make sure we have the right item selected. So I'm gonna go back to the collapsed portion here and choose this banner product item. All I have to do is click on the smart item checkbox, and it is now a dynamic item that's available to be mapped, which I showed you guys at the beginning of this presentation. It's got a little icon here which correlates to its icon over here in the layers list, so you can also quickly at a glance see which of your elements are dynamic. We can go ahead and on this panel, we can make this dynamic as well. We'll give it a better name, so this will be panel product. Check the smart item box. And then we wanted this text line to be dynamic as well, so I'm gonna go ahead and call this smart copy because I believe that's what we had set in the finished product. And if we scroll down, we'll just check that smart item as well. And now you guys can quickly see at a glance we have three dynamic elements that are ready to be mapped through our platform. We won't go ahead and animate the entire ad because that would take some time, but I will go ahead and show you guys a couple quick animations just so that you can see how easy it is to add those. So we'll go ahead and fade in the logo, and we'll go ahead and fly in this little drone real quick. So we'll go ahead and start with the logo. Since I'm gonna fade in that logo, first of all, I want it to not be shown on load because otherwise there's nothing to fade in, it's already visible. Now, we'll go ahead and create a new event, create a new animation event. And there are a lot of different triggering events that we could choose. In this case, I'm gonna go ahead and choose on expand. So when this panel expands, we want the animation to trigger. There's also on load, which is great for the collapsed portion of the ad. And recently, we also added on visible. So you can also wait until the ad is visible on the page to have your animation trigger, as well as a few other options in here. And now we want to choose which animation we want to happen. So we have a few different animation options. They can be combined to do some much more interesting or complex animations than what I'm going to show you right now. And I'll show you an example of some more complex animation that other people have done at the end here. But I'm going to go ahead and just choose fade in. And now all I need to do is tell this what I want to fade in. So I just need to select a target here. So in this case, we wanted to fade in image 2. As you can see, that logo is highlighted or selected up there. And that's pretty much it unless I want to change the options. So I can change the duration. I can set, easing if I want to. And I can also set how much of a delay I want this to happen at. You guys can see we have no other animation for this to happen after or with, but these will be selectable in just a second with the next animation that I add. So I'm gonna go ahead and collapse the fade in. We'll just leave the default options for the sake of time, and we'll go ahead and add one more animation. So let's say after the logo fades in, that's when I want this product image to slide in. So we'll add another action, and I'm going to go ahead and choose slide in. And now I have to tell it what I want to slide in, so that's going to be the panel product. And in this case, I want it to happen after the previous animation. I could also choose with, or I could choose on trigger to set a specific time. I can also manually drag this to set when I want it to happen, and I can change the duration on either side here. So that is kind of a quick visual timeline. Down here you can see we have seconds, and you can zoom in and out on that. But I just want this to happen after, so I'm just going to choose that option. The only other thing left to do really is choose the starting coordinates. It'll end where it currently is on the stage. So I can manually choose those, or I can choose this little component tool and just kind of click where I want it to start. So it's a great visual option there. Again, duration and easing options down here. So now if I were to quickly preview the animation, and this is just a quick preview, so if we were to actually demo it in the platform, this would look a little bit smoother, but that just allows us to roughly see, is our animation happening the way we want it to? So from here, I've actually completely finished building the ad in the demo. Obviously, we're short a couple animations due to time, but we built a expandable banner. It has a scaling responsive panel. We've got three dynamic elements in the ad. We also quickly added some video and some click-throughs to this. The next step would be actually just to save this to our platform, and because our ad builder is completely integrated with Seismic's platform, it's very easy to do. All you would have to do is click save, and this ad will be placed directly in our platform. From there, it's just mapping the dynamic elements in the way that I showed, and then it can be handed off to media teams for trafficking. So there's no need to bundle the ad in a workspace, manually upload to our platform, any of that. It's directly integrated. I do want to show you guys a couple other examples of ads that were built using our ad builder. We obviously built a very simple looking ad today, but people have built some really cool and complex things using our ad builder as well. I'm going to go ahead and refresh this demo. This was entirely built in our ad builder. It uses some more complex animation. So, you know, if you had more than the, like, 15, 20 minutes that we just spent building the ad that we just built, you'd be able to build something much more complex and rich. We also have a couple other ads that are a little bit more interactive. This one's got a video that autoplays on the top, and there's an on-rollover event here. This cute little character that pops down. And then this ad is actually an ad where a creative agency used our ad builder as more of a rapid development tool and then went in and added some animation using third-party libraries. Our ad builder does fully support using JavaScript and CSS to actually manipulate elements on the stage. So what they did was they built this ad very quickly in ad builder and then used these buttons, set an on-click function that then called the actual code that they used with a third-party animation library. So you can fully integrate anything else that you want to use for more complex animations and just use our tool as more of like a rapid building solution if you don't want to do all of your animation directly timeline-based as well. So that's pretty much the quick demo of Ad Builder. I believe we probably have time for a couple questions if anyone has any.
For the dynamic text portion, mm-hmm. if Toyota needed a specific font for that dynamic text, is there a way to use whatever brand font the brand needs?
Yeah. So in ad builder, you'll just want to select the text field that you need to adjust the font on, and you can add a custom font. So I know that a lot of brands obviously use specific fonts for different things. In our tool, we only have a few of the basic options built in. So if they have it hosted, you can add a web font, or you can upload a font file directly from your computer, and it will use that font for any text that's then loaded in. So then the dynamic text will just automatically use that font for that text field.
For the dynamic text stuff, like, or the images or whatnot, like, what's driving that dynamic text? Are you guys using any, like, targeting to drive the different messages?
So you can. Our platform does targeting in a lot of different ways. I mean, you can do geo-targeting, you can do different types of rotations, you can do retargeting, and so what's driving that is just going to depend on your actual strategy. In this case, this is like a product retail vertical demo, so it's likely probably going to be like a retargeting type campaign. So that our platform would actually be fully driving that. From the creative perspective, all we need to do is just build the ad out as kind of like almost like a template, if you will, to allow for those dynamic elements to be pulled in. And then our platform controls, okay, well, you know, they visited this product, so we need to retarget based off of that. Let's pull this version of the ad in that's using this product. So using a combination of what our platform offers in retargeting allows you to integrate directly with the dynamic ads that you build in Ad Builder.
Hi. My name is DJ. I work with Ink and Fast Company magazine as a creative developer.
Yeah.
Wondering if we're stuck without an internet connection, do you guys have an offline tool we can use to develop with?
Ad Builder right now only works within our platform when you're logged in and online. That being said, Seismic really allows a variety of third-party tools to be uploaded into our platform. So. You know, you can use third-party ad builders if you want to in Seismic. This tool, though, does require you to be logged in to our platform to use.
Okay. Cool. Thank you, Katie.
Yeah.
I was really glad to see the visible option to start the animation. So we are all starting to work about viewability. Next up, we have Sam from Flash Talking.
Thank you to everybody for being here and all the other presenters. Really happy to be here. For those of you who aren't familiar with Flash Talking, we're a cross-channel data activation platform intended to build, create, and serve, measure data-driven advertising. Part of the platform, one of the tools that we provide sheepishly is the Flash Talking HTML5 ad builder. So it's not the same thing, but it's very similar. It's also a web application. So let me just move on to our next slide here. So the ad builder is actually, it's ideal for enabling easy creation of HTML5 content that's served through the Flash Talking platform. It's good for partners that may not have access to a full development team or not very experienced developers. It eliminates the need to do any coding, but it's still capable of producing very engaging HTML content. And the main thing is it enables the clients to activate key business data for targeting campaigns, delivering personalized messaging to users. So moving on to what I'm going to do today is I'm going to show an example of some client work and introduce the Ad Builder application, and then I'm going to reproduce a version of the client's programmatic creative that leverages their data feed for in-creative dynamic content. The client is B&H Photo, and they were gracious enough to give us permission to use their work for our presentation, almost like a case study, but really to demonstrate how the Ad Builder platform can be worked within for data activation. So a little bit of the background is they have an extensive product database that they wanted to leverage for use in their HTML5 ads to be run across screens and platforms. And the campaign goal was really to be able to target messaging that was relevant to each individual user, and that would be based on data from customer website actions, you know, standard things like page visits, product views, product carting or purchase conversions. And then from that, the visitor would be segmented, and subsequently the segmented users could then be served targeted ads by our Flash Talking ad serving platform. And depending on you know, the user's interactions or the insights that we had from the website visits, and also, you know, bundling that with the client strategy for messaging to the audience segment, then the creative insight would be dynamically populated by the data feed. So without further ado, let me see. I think I need to swap over to my web browser, Google Chrome. Okay, that's us, Flash Talking. So this is the work that I'm going to show you. It's fairly straightforward. It looks kind of simple in terms of what's going on, but let me give a quick explanation of what's happening in here. So this banner is pulling in, as I mentioned earlier, live data feed from the client's product catalog. And the data is automatically converted into carousel component within Ad Builder, and then that component is then populated with product information from the feed. And the actual production really involves adding custom animation to the different elements that are pulled into the feed. So moving along, I'll give you a quick walkthrough of the Ad Builder platform. So this here is, let me just make sure that I'm logged in. Okay, so this is our common interface login. And here I have, you know, under this login, I have access to Ad Builder and our Creative Manager interfaces. I'm going to go ahead and launch Ad Builder. Log in here. So for the purpose of this demonstration, I'm going to just open up a blank project. But we have an ad wizard for creating some really quick sort of preset templated ads, a few blank templates, and then some demo projects that you could have built your own templates for. So just as a walkthrough for the platform, I'm going to have this blank ad. So the first thing I want to draw your attention to is our menu bar here. This is where you have your standard application functionality for saving, opening, previewing, and your assets. Here's a quick shortcut to save, shortcut to open your assets, a shortcut for your Actions Manager preview shortcut. The next thing is the main workspace, which would be your stage, and the stage is for positioning and editing your creative elements. Following that, let me close that for a second. Following that, we have our timeline, which allows you to control the playback of the ad. And the items that you bring onto the stage will draw their own layers within your timeline. So this is fairly familiar for users of other visual design tools, and we wanted to have that comfortable feeling, comfortable, familiar feel. The next panel that I want you to see is the components panel. And this is where we have, you know, most of your standard features for interactions and element creation, like click tags, interaction areas, text and shape, and social buttons. Some of the more rich features involve adding video or YouTube video, like map embedding, carousels and galleries. You know, so like something that I can show very quickly would be a YouTube video embed. And then we just hit preview, and we'll see that you know, it just works, which is kind of nice. And essentially, it's just a matter of plugging in the YouTube ID into the properties panel. So I get rid of that guy. Continuing on, right now there's a feeds panel, but we haven't imported a feed yet. So I'm going to skip that and return to that as we open up and work on the actual project. The following palette here is the images, which is the library of your assets that you've imported. The animations palette is for creating individual animations within the pages, and they have their own timeline and their own actions and components that you can add to them. The next is your contextual property panel, which allows you to modify any of the settings for the different elements that you introduced to your project. And finally, you have the actions palette, where you would set up the different types of points of interaction on the elements or on the timeline. I just want to point out that our action manager is kind of set up in a way to have fairly readable syntax for anyone that is just creating something. So it'd be like on click of, and then you select whatever item that you have, then do this, or then trigger something or other. You know, so it kind of makes sense, just kind of readability-wise, if you're not really familiar with coding. So that's long and short of the overall interface. And this little question mark here pops up the Ad Builder help screen, which you can learn more about each of the different things that I just spoke about. Okay, so now that we've got through the overall walkthrough, I mean, it's pretty standard. Everyone is familiar with some kind of visual design interface. I'm going to go ahead and open up a project that I started working on. Let's see here. And I'm going to start here. So this is just to get the ball rolling a little bit. I've already set up a couple of the elements on the stage using our shape tool for this little blue background area. I've already imported the logo image. I've already set up the text tool so I can hopefully not lose your attention going through this multiple times. Let me see if I could. Okay. So first thing I want to do is go ahead and open up our Assets Manager. And here I'm going to go ahead and just browse for one final image that I'm going to add here. It's just going to be a little arrow PNG. I'm going to open that up. And the next asset that I want to bring in is our custom font. It could be drag and drop if you wish, but for the purpose of this demo, I'm just browsing for it. And as the font is uploaded, it's converted into the different types of formats that would be compatible across the different browsers. So let's take a look at the text layer that we have already on the stage. It was originally set to Times New Roman, so I'm just going to set it to our custom font there. And I'm going to go ahead and create another product feed. Sorry, my notes are all over the place. Okay, there we go. Here's our text. And drag guy on stage. Paste them in there. All right. I apologize. This process can feel a little tedious. But for the purpose of the walkthrough, I think it's probably important to actually see how this is done. So this is just updating the color of our text, and then I'm going to go ahead and set the properties. Okay, so after that, the next thing that I want to show you is, so this drop-down menu here is where you can add pages, and the pages would be for adding different panels for your project, like an expand panel, but it's also where you would actually add your different types of custom animations. So I'm going to open up this animation here. You know, it's funny, I actually didn't realize I already had this created. I'm going to go ahead and delete it and then recreate it just to go through the process here. All right, so we see that the animation is no longer there. And I'm going to go ahead and create a new animation. So this is a new panel. And within this, I'm going to grab that arrow that we had just created. First thing, this arrow is going to be our little button for advancing our carousel. So the stage for the animation itself is actually going to be only 25 pixels wide and 25 pixels high. Grab this guy, fit it to the stage. And for the sake of adding a little bit of animation, and this is where I can show you how setting up an action works. When we initially encounter this, I'm going to start at onReach of 0 seconds. I just want it to be stopped, so I don't want the animation to play automatically. Following that, if I roll over that arrow animation, I actually want it to play. So in this case, the source is the actual page that contains the animation. And it's just going to go to and play the next bit of time on the timeline. And then I also want to make sure that when I roll out of it, the animation goes back to its source. So choosing this stage again, we're going to go to and stop at 0 seconds. Okay, so let me close out of the action manager. Nope, hold on a second. 5 seconds. I also want to make sure it stops. Okay. So the actual animation that I'm going to create is just going to be a very subtle opacity change. So initially, this arrow animation is just going to be sort of a light opacity. And then when you roll over it, it'll trigger the animation to 100% opacity. Let me go ahead and return to the main page. And I'm going to add that animation to the stage now. So put this guy. This guy right here. And I'll name him Arrow Next. And what I want to do is, I actually want to duplicate this. I'm going to go to the timeline and find a layer to duplicate it. I'm going to duplicate it onto the main page. And I'm going to rename this one, Arrow Previous. And I'm going to just move them over to the left side of the stage. And since we want to pointing in the correct direction, we're going to flip them upside down. There we go. All right, so let me just save here and then do a quick preview of the little animation that we created. Make sure that the rollover and roll-off feature is working. I'm not sure how clear that comes across on the projection, but that's basically what we've got going on right now. All right, moving along, let me show you now how we go ahead and import data feed. So let me find the data feed. Now, the actual data feed endpoint or the URL would be coming from our feeds team. So on the onset of the campaign, what you would want to do, you would have your campaign management tool, campaign manager liaison here in touch with the advertising client to provide us with the raw data feed that they would want to implement into the creative. And then our feeds team would actually be, we have a tool called the Power Feeds tool. It's not currently available for external use. It will be soon. I can show you what that looks like a little bit afterwards when we have some more time. But for the moment, they would basically take the raw feed of from your advertising client, and then they would run it through this tool, and that tool would parse out the information and make the feed available to the ad builder. And then from there, whoever would be building it could access the Power Feeds interface, look up the feed endpoint that they want, copy it, and then put it directly into the feed manager within Ad Builder. So opening up the feed manager here, right now we see we don't have any feeds here. So I'm going to go ahead and add a feed. And this URL is obtained from the Power Feeds interface, or in this case, it would have been obtained from the feeds team. And this is where you can set the different segments that you would want targeted for this particular ad. I'll go ahead and submit that to the processes. And you can see that all the different nodes associated with the advertiser's feeds come out here and the different types of elements they are. So now that we have that feed imported, we can go back over here and take a look at our project, and we see that we have now a carousel in here, which is the product feed. I'm going to go ahead and resize this a little bit, fit it to the stage, and I believe I had 205 height. So at the moment, it doesn't actually have anything, right? So it brings in the product carousel as its own animation. So switching over here, we can see that there's nothing in here. But we see that the actual, all the different feed elements and the different nodes that were parsed show up in the panel. So I'm going to kind of just open this up a little bit and pull out some of the elements that I originally had. So bear with me as I do a little bit of resizing magic. Okay. That I'm gonna actually drop them over here because that's where I want them to first appear. The title we're gonna have. So I'm gonna update this font size and align height. 20. The color. I actually want to make sure that I'm using the correct custom font. And I'll reposition and resize it. All right. Next item that we're looking for, and I want him to animate in afterwards. So I'm just going to set the starting point over here on the timeline. Here we are. Right. I'm going to update that color. Now, yeah, we got. Match up with the alignment. And yeah, just drag it out a little bit. There we go. That should do. that I wanted to add in here. That will be the promo ribbon. Oh. Hold on a second. I'm sorry. It's actually the ribbon URL. So this is going to indicate whether or not this particular item has some special sale to it. I'm going to give it a little bit of a rotation. All right. Okay. I think I may have accidentally added those in there. So quick animation of these elements that are on here. I'm going to just double his size. Or rather, increase it a little bit. So that when the animation starts for the slide, trust me, this is worth it. It's amazing. Okay. Okay. So we're gonna. This is gonna be our final keyframe for the title. Final keyframe for the price. Final keyframe for the ribbon URL. The little widget that tells you if there's anything special going on. Our title is going to start from a little bit further up. I'm going to give it an opacity and add some easing to it. So this is just going to ease out. So you can drag on the timeline, get a preview of what it's going to look like. And subsequently, we'll also have the same sort of animation for the price. And we'll also add a little bit of ease out there. And for this, we will just increase the size, bring it down like a stamp, and also give it an opacity of 0. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and save that and come back to my main page and do a quick preview to see what we've got. I think it took a second to load in. So this is basically, so that little widget that, you know, will be there or not depending on the product. You'll see it's kind of like a nice little additional thing that shows you whether or not, whether or not that, you know, there's like a special value to the particular product. Now we have these, buttons with the carousel by default, but we're gonna go ahead and get rid of those buttons. And also, I think the actual size of the pricing text is a little bit small. Might have been breaking onto two lines there. So I should make sure that we can accommodate. All right, I'm gonna go back to the main page, select my carousel on the stage. I'm gonna hide the controls. And then we're gonna assign some controls to the actual arrows that we spent some time to create before. So I'm going to choose my actions manager. I'm going to add a new action, and it'll be on click. The source is going to be arrow next. Then I'm going to select an effect, which is going to be go to the next slide. And that'll be on the cross-sell carousel that we had added. Okay. And then I'm going to do the same for the previous arrow. So on click of previous arrow, we're going to go to the previous slide on our product carousel. Okay. So now if we save and preview, we should see that the default arrows of the carousel that were brought in are no longer there. And the arrows that we have set up are working properly. All right, so let's go ahead. There we go. Perfect. So this is a quick recreation. Naturally, there's only one product in here. It would have taken a bit longer to add in some of the additional bells and whistles that we had in here. So this is actually that same carousel, but it actually takes three items. I'm going to go ahead and open up that project. But first, let me make sure I've just saved that. Because when we do the preview here, so since the, I forgot to show you guys. So there's a little exclamation point here for the project details. If you click on that, reminds me that I didn't actually set up any quick tags. You can also see what the file size information for this particular ad is. So the quick tag that I actually want to set up in here is going to be within the carousel. So since each product has its own product page, we're just going to bring, so this within the feeds component, one of the nodes is the URL, and you can see that it's an interaction button. So let me just update the, there we go. So now that's going to go ahead and click through. Let me do a quick save again and preview. So this will now allow our ad to click through to the specific product page that's demonstrated or that's displayed in the ad. So let's go, oh look, there's a rebate on this Google Chromecast. And in the testing state, it'll bring you to this intermediary flash talking test page, and you'll see the actual end URL that the user will go to. So we hit the test, and it brings you to that page. So just to recap, you know, for the most part, it was pretty straightforward. You know, the actual build within our ad builder is not too different from what most people would encounter in visual design tools. It's fairly straightforward. You could make your animations as complex or as involved as you want. The thing that I really wanted to highlight here was the relative ease with which we were able to implement a feed and bring the specific product in as dynamic content. And you'll get to see how it ties into the rest of the platform. Let me come over to our creative manager. And I'm going to go ahead and launch this. And we'll see that this tool, this unit that we had was here is a product feed carousel, build a new font. So opening Creative Manager, you get to see a list of the creative libraries for your particular account. The one that I was working in was the HTML platform showcase. So I'm going to double click on that. And we'll see the different ads that were uploaded to this, or actually, these ads were all ad builder ads, so whatever we built in ad builder will appear here. And the one that we were just working on is product feed carousel build. So this is the one that didn't have a font and didn't have any animation set up in there. And I'm going to go ahead and I'll do a quick preview just to make sure everything converted over here properly. And that's it. And for the purpose of sharing previews to the rest of your team or to the actual client, you can go ahead to the test and ad server page or the creative preview page and generate a preview URL that you can send. And this URL is only valid as long as the creator of the ad allows it to. It can be turned off for privacy purposes. That way the links are sent out. You can retain control of who gets to view the work. And of course, being this is HTML5, we've included a little QR code to scan so you can test the functionality on mobile devices. And I think that's mainly it. Let me go ahead and come back to my notes for a second. I'm sorry. I barely really introduced any of the creative managers. So the creative manager here, it lists out all of the ad files that you have in your particular campaign. These are all variations of the demo build that I had. It gives you basic information regarding whether or not it has dynamic elements, the type of ad that it is, the format, whether or not it has expanding capabilities, the file size, the different types of rich media capabilities. So this is the basic interface that you would use for reviewing your ads when they're completed, and then you can go ahead and after you have approval from your advertiser, you would submit them for quality assurance. Now, looking at that B&H unit, I just want to do a quick walkthrough just to show you the differences and show you why it was different. The B&H product carousel here is pretty much the same thing that we have going on here, but you'll see that their developer added a nice little animation to the actual carousel itself. That way, each time you click it, it has like that nice swooping animation. And also because they wanted to show multiple items in the carousel, within the carousel properties, they chose to have multi-items selected, and they displayed three items. And if you were to look at the actual individual slide, you'll see that the individual slides were sized down to fit three on the stage. And they have a similar type of animation going on, but they also have that nice little rollover interactivity that we saw in the creative preview here. I think that's mostly it. This is a quick glance at our PowerPage interface. I can't really show you that much right now, but the actual output after the raw data is sent into this interface will be the different types of the different endpoints that you see here. So there's like a purchase, view, and carding, and then you can also choose the different segments that you want to apply to your creative. And that's how it all kind of ties together. And let me just do one more. So our last slide is right here. Just kind of to sum everything up, why do you want to use our HTML5 ad builder platform? It's really just because the platform handles all of the heavy lifting, the coding and integration of components, assets, and the logic. And then building the ad units within our ad builder platform means the units are already optimized for serving in the Flash Talking ad serving and metrics platform. There's no need to package up any of your code and send it around, or open up someone else's files and add custom tracking code. And the creative campaign would ultimately be able to target messaging that was relevant to each individual user. And based on, you know, whatever actions and however the advertiser wants to use their campaign strategy. That's it. Thank you very much. Does anyone have questions?
In that ad builder tool, are you able to apply like custom events to each of like the little thumb buttons that you had on the bottom right? Are you able to apply like custom events or stuff like that for like ITR tracking?
What kind of tracking?
Like interaction rates?
There are custom tracking events that can be added in here. Let me double check what we've got here. But if there are anything, so what I didn't actually show is, within Ad Builder, there's also a capability to add custom code. And if there's anything that is not already available with the event manager, the developer would actually be able to go in and add some additional code for custom tracking type of events if it's not already built in. And also, I forgot to, kind of as a reminder, our Ad Builder tool is really intended for users that may not have a lot of development experience or for quick turnaround. But this is actually built on top of the Flash Talking HTML5 API, which could be introduced into any type of HTML5 ad, and it ties that hand-built ad to the rest of the platform in the same way that an ad builder tool would. So let me just, to clarify, the ad builder tool is for easier build, and if you have a development team that actually wants to customize the work, or you actually have ad files that were created in some other tools, you could just implement the HTML5 API from Flash Talking and turn those ads into Flash Talking platform ads. I hope that answered your question. Okay, thank you. Okay.
Thank you, Sam.
Yeah. Responsive web design. Okay, I got it. Oh, wait. Did you open up a new one?
Nope, it was down your taskbar there.
Okay, good. Okay. Is it shared?
Not yet. Yeah, just go to a quick start there. Go to share screen for me.
Okay. Kind of, we founded the company back in 2012 and spent the last 4 years really building a platform around this completely fluid creative. One of our agency partners that does work with Sotheby's actually said to us, "Wow, you guys are like water. Have you ever seen the Bruce Lee quote, be water, my friend?" So up until now, design has been very much about fixed sizes. And when you change your mindset to build something completely fluid, the biggest problem everyone has been asking us, how do I get approval when every pixel has to be fluid no matter where it goes, from watches all the way to digital signage? And so we've basically created a product. We built it from the ground up, really looking at the paradigm of responsive to screen, user, and context. And user we put second before context, because we have to create great ads. We have to create great ads because users just do not engage on ads. 2.14%, this is stats just this month from Google. So 97.86% of the time, users don't hover, they don't touch, they just don't engage with them. And so we've set out to create really responsive ads that users want to engage, create a platform that designers can create award-winning creative. That's our mission. That's our vision. And so the fast, easy, pixel-perfect, it's got to be pixel-perfect way to create premium, impactful, and engaging ads consumers love. And so we are getting there. Look at these bloody results. Click-through rate, 0.14% on average. Overall, we've served several billion impressions for the platform across dozens of publishers and major brands, and our overall results are 2 times the industry standard, 3 times the engagement rate, and those include all of the IAB fixed sizes. But when you actually do an edge-to-edge banner that fits the space beautifully, we're seeing 3 to 5 times and then even 4 times the engagement overall for the entire everything we've done. But when you actually create these really immersive, beautifully creative, up to 50 times the engagement rate. And so that's where we're going, really immersive, responsive ads. And so how do we do this? We needed to create a platform where a designer, a developer, has all of the tools of the web out there and be able to embed whatever they want. So we call it, you know, anything embeds. If you can dream it and you're a developer, you can do it with our platform. So we're really big on partnerships. We've partnered with GreenSock. We have a GUI coming on top of the GreenSock API. We're working with Monotype. We got Theo here. We got the best-in-class web font platform that has everything when it comes to fonts, and making them really responsive, and all the different effects you can do with fonts. And then on top of that, how do you know that the ad is great? So we've been really focused on analytics and measurements. So our UI includes a responsive cross-screen analytics platform that we're about to launch, and so you can send your results to the management right away, and the screen is responsive, so you can always get your analytics on the fly very quickly. So we've been working on that. That's coming out this week. And then we are working on the ability to have all the hovers, engagements. So we've seen the metrics of ads from
impressions to viewability, but what about engagement? So we've been really focused on engagement and being able to see those engagements. So in real time, you can actually make creative updates, do those things that you want, and fix those ads on the fly. And so that's where we're going. And so what I want to show you today is, look, of all the complex stuff, let's distill this down to the basics. The world has been moving to programmatic. And our product, we call it Stretch. A team came from mobile. I ran mobile advertising for Nokia globally. And so the whole team is the DNA of mobile. Everything has to work beautifully on mobile. Our ads also work on mobile apps, and we're extending them to wearables. But with that said, how do you deal with this programmatic? So that's one of the big things that we've been, you know, why we're a part of the IAB. But we have a product we call Programmatic Stretch, where our creative will actually fit into any of the existing IAB slots and then stretch to fill the white space. So as you can see there, we have a 728 by 90 on the page. Why do we have white space on both sides? It's not a great experience for the user, and for the publisher, they get this thing floating in the middle of the page. We want it so at the edge to edge. With the Fluid 90, where it just goes edge to edge, fits, we've seen 2x the engagement rates. And also you can have the proportional unit, which is part of the standards, where it can actually grow and actually fit even as a 728 proportional stretch. So I'm going to show you, and we're going to build that out today, but let's go make a pizza. We're all hungry. We've been here. Let's go do that. So before I start, you can go and you can sign up. The tools are free. Just remember IAB and responsive ads and do a search, and you can find the page or go there. We also have a YouTube channel with a gallery of different videos of some of the stuff we've done. Or just send an email, IAB at responsive ads, easy to remember, or Matt at responsive ads. Okay. So let's begin. So first of all, I just want to show you the ad we're going to build. So this is on a responsive ads demo page. As you can see there, this is the stretch. It actually stretches left and right. And as you can see, even the 300 by 600 is also responsive. We've gotten a lot of requests. We want our 300 by 600 to change to a 160 by 600 for tablets. And so, you know, and it just goes down. And that's an example of for the 90. And then we also have a quick example here for that proportional unit here, which is the larger one. Okay. So when you come to our product, we have a dashboard, has tutorials, we have a support and community. Basically, the way it's done is you use format. So think of ads like water. So we have a responsive creative that's water, and then a format is a cup. So you can have as many different sizes, shapes to that container, as we call it. We call that a format. And so you select your formats. A lot of our publisher partners have formats. We have a completely fluid format, expandable format, sidekick format, skin formats, any formats that you want. You can have a tag for that format that gets deployed. Everything we do now is hosted, but we do have our product also being offered as a zip file. We like the hosted solution because everything is dynamic, so the payload is less than 50K, and everything is pulled dynamically, so it's optimized. It's lean for mobile, and it could be as rich and retina for large 4K screens. So we've built it in a way that everything can get dynamically loaded, and we've stuck with the cloud solution. Very quickly, as you can see here, this is our creative menu. You can sort, you can have everything by the brands. Very easy to sort things, just the rad pizza that I'm going to show you today, and different things that we've done with partners, so really easy. And then we have a template. We just grabbed four templates here to show you. Any creative that you make can be converted into a template, but we have responsive templates. A template for responsive is challenging. When you have one creative fits all sizes, how do you change the elements so that they all work across, say, 40, 50 different sizes, if you might have those? So we have those series of templates. We have what we call our media gallery, which is where you can keep all of your images and animations. We've embedded the ability to upload different Adobe animations and then different code snippets and then fonts as well. And then here's different custom formats that you might want to build out. So let's create HTML5 pizza. And so you can start with a blank canvas. You can start with, a lot of designers have already built one size in Photoshop. We, like I said, we love partnerships, so we've made it so that everything can integrate very easily to all of Adobe design tools. That's where we want to go. We want to integrate into everybody. And so being able to use PSDs or you can select a template. So I'm going to start with a PSD today. And then here's your different formats. So you can have your edge-to-edge billboards. You can even have swapping out IAB sizes. You can have adhesions, all sizes in one format, and the programmatic stretch. I'll show you that today. Skins. We even have multi-stage formats, pushdowns, overlays that are set up really simply and clean here. I will add the IAB format, and I'm going to add all sizes. So you can add as many different formats all when you have the workflow around that one Fluid Creative. And then the advertiser today is Rad Pizza. So this is the only thing required in the details. One of our partners said we need to have that in there so our ad ops can actually sort it easily, so we made that one required. Designers don't necessarily like to tag things. So proceed to editor. So now you upload your PSD file. You go here and you grab your PSD file. I will grab my rasterized starter kit. It uploads, and I've already done that, so now there it is. It uploaded. So I didn't put a background in there on purpose, because I wanted to show how you can actually easily set up a background. So you could just go here. So this was designed pretty much laid out where you have all of your formats here on the left, all the sizes where you can add, remove your sizes. You can actually save. You can create new formats. You can add new formats while you're in the editor. And then here's all of your different elements. So for each different element type, you can add backgrounds, grouping elements, buttons, images, a response, our canvas where you can embed anything you want, carousel, skins, different feeds, social icons. And we have our own integrated video player with 360 video capabilities that's being extended in the near future, as well as YouTube. So you have all of those different element types. And so I'm going to add here a background element, and I'm going to add with it an image that I want to put into the background element. So I can keep that image very light and just have it float as CSS in that image. So here we go. Where's the background? Okay, whoops. There we go. And then I'm just going to go to the background and just turn on that image. Let me just reset here. There we go. There we go. And so now the wood is part of that background image. And then I'm just going to turn off the other one. Now, as you can see, everything is layered, so you can actually move the background to the bottom. There we go. And then the elements, I have the elements random here to show how easy it is to lay them out. But there's the background. As you can see, it filled very nicely. And then in the background element, you can actually set up animations. You can have borders. You can do different things like putting different patterns in there as such, as well as you can even have its own call to action. So you can set up all the different call to actions there. One of the things I want to show you is this PSD happened to be 1.57 megs. We also have optimizers. You can optimize with lossy or lossless. It actually takes everything down in size. It's a very simple process, so you can have automatic optimization. And so let's look and build this out. So if I actually grab the pizza, now the way we do it is we do it by everything, we anchor it. So as it's fluid in the container, how do the pieces fit into the container? So for instance here, I'm going to anchor the pizza to the left vertical edge as such, and I'm going to anchor the right piece to the right vertical edge, and I'm going to make it zero, so it's aligned to the edge, and I'm going to do the same thing with the pizza. I'm going to have that zero aligned. There we go. And then here we have, this was a tagline that was actually a rasterized image as a reference. I'm going to go in here and add, hold on a second, I'm going to go in here and add a text box element. There we go, text box. And just make it white, and then I'm going to give it a font. There we go. And then also, if you don't have the fonts available, you can actually go here and upload any web kit, and including if a lot of custom fonts, a lot of our partners use custom fonts, so. Even if you do have the rights, you can actually have it converted into Font Squirrel, and that is hosted. You have to have the licensing rights by Monotype. So this is integrated into the Monotype platform. So there we go. And so we recently, so that the actual text is responsive. So I'll just grab this here, and I'm going to move it here. I'm actually just going to center that. Center that, here we go, center and anchor it to the top, and I'll grab our logo, I'm going to center and anchor that to the top as such, and I'm going to turn off the tagline, so now we have our text there. Let me just make sure this is anchored to the bottom, and that one is anchored to the center left, there we go. So everything looks great, and then I'll just put in here I'm in a bad position here. Hold on. And then we also have these things. So put the little registered, and then even I'll just add that like that. Okay, and I'm going to stretch this. Whoops. There we go, and that's centered as such. Okay, so now as you can see here, if we just shrink that, if we just go here and change the height to say 8%, it will actually change, and I'm just going to center it as such. There we go. All right, so now we have the 600, and then now that we've pretty much laid it out, we like to start with the vertical sizes, the fixed heights. If you lay out all those three, then basically you get everything. So if I click on the 400, there it laid it out, the logo. I did not set the logo height. So I'm going to actually set that as well. There we go. And I'm going to, and this one here was anchored to the bottom, and I'm going to make that also. There we go. And then 250. And then if I click on the text box, it comes there. And actually, I'm going to make this a little bit smaller as well. There we go. I can actually make the text a little bit bigger. Perfect. And then, whoops. I just want to go here just to save a little time. And in this one here, the actual, just because we didn't have a lot of time, I actually just laid out the 90. Okay, so now we have all those, and then it's as simple as then just going through a bunch of different sizes that were preset in the format. So if I just click here, boom. So just if you make things absolute or relative, they can shrink or change sizes, and then you pretty much have the flexibility to lay out everything you want pretty much pixel perfectly. And then you get to a certain point at a certain size, and you can just wrap. And so when you get to different sizes, things get a little smaller. I'm going to change the font height to 15. There we go. And all the way down. And I'm going to actually anchor now the pizza to the right. So now as I move this, the pizza will move with that. And so if you want to go in there and you go to a specific size, and you want to add another size, you can add as many different sizes in there as you like to keep it completely fluid. Make that absolute. Change that to percentage, and now you can shrink up and lock it proportionally. There we go. And the pizza kind of went off there. But so basically, we've done that, and then based on that, as once you lay out all those, then essentially you basically have everything then that is fluid. I did want to show quickly on these sizes here, you could just lay out just for those different sizes where it switches. So you can go on and turn on any elements that you like. We even, as you can see, the grouping of the leaves are in a group. So you have those kind of advanced features. Okay. So any questions on layout? You can also go here and add a video. So I can show you, let's see the example here where the video is in the background. So you can add a video into it. And now, so let me show you a couple more features. So when you actually save and publish, it takes you to this preview page, gives you the ability to see all the different devices. And then as you design, you can create as many different tags and add any of the UTMs into the creative, your own click trackers. So anything, any kind of other impression, analytics tools, ComScore, Nielsen, any of those can be added directly in here. You can add as many as you want. Every single element can also have its own analytics. So you can add anything to any of the elements. You can turn on separate ones for mobile, for wearable, for anything as you like. And then you can set privileges. We do have fallbacks, so you can actually automatically generate fallbacks for all the low-end devices, so everything from IE6. We're actually working on more dynamic for some of the lower-end as well. And so... So this is then we have a preview page here that you can actually share around. You can see how the ads look on all the different devices and actually toggle orientation. So making it really easy with all the different formats that you have. So you can actually see all the different formats and then all the different deployments. So if you have, so we find that a lot of the brands and agencies that we work with, they want to have, be able to send out specifically for each client. So you can actually send out all the different deployments by format or you know, by deployment. And so that is the quick overview. As you can see here, here's our analytics. We just did some clicks on that to show and has everything, all the status quo analytics plus all the engagements metrics. You can set up export and then messaging. And let me just quickly show you the template. So so basically what you would do is you can go into any of these creatives, and you can just go here, save as a template. You can also easily preview. If you save as a template, it creates that template here in your template folder. And then, you know, as the designer, you'd want to set that up so it'd be easy to use. So you don't have to change all the elements. You can set it up. So we've been working with brands where they want the marketing manager, someone that even is not even at the design level, to be able to go in and use the template. Template's really for creating as many different variants as you want very quickly and easily. So that's also the challenge. If you have hundreds of different versions, design creative versions you want to do, how do you make them really easy to integrate that in? And so basically here's, let me just go in and show you that. So if you want to create a new version, you select the template. You can name it, so let's just say Party Time. Next, and then you can actually change the advertiser to the IAB from Responsive Ads. Proceed to Editor, and then I will open that up. And so now I'm in the editor. As you see, it doesn't have all the elements anymore. You can actually go into the settings and turn on and off the different elements that you don't want to touch, that you want to lock down, and then just the ones that you want the user to change. And you can see here we have more than, this is about 40, 50 different sizes that have been automatically set up. You don't necessarily, you want to change one element and have it fill for all those sizes. So in here, the text box, I'm going to go into the text box and edit that and say, hold on a second here. Get a bigger size. There we go. Okay, and then I'm going to go here and I'm going to replace the IAB logo, which I have in my gallery there. And as you can see, it's a different proportion. So I'll just put that there as such. Now I copy across all styles. So let me copy across all styles. And then as you can see, now we just have a QA just to go in and slightly tweak them. So. And then we can just go next, next, next. Yeah, the smaller ones, the IAB was a little bit off because of the proportion. There we go. Now it's been automatically fixed. And then we can go through. And so if there's any little tweaks, and you can just quickly go through all of the sizes and just basically have everything, and if there's something that's a little bit off, you can fix that, and you have the slider to check it, and then go through all the sizes. There we go. API ID was a little bit bigger for that proportion. So it's actually dynamically doing it by proportion together with the layout. We have an algorithm that does that. And so sometimes it's not perfect, but it's still fast. And there we go. That's good. Good, 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 good. All those sizes. Check all those. And then you can go down and check the all the IAB sizes. And that one there, yeah, that was a little bit off. So it gives you the ability to check everything. And then there we go. So we have all the sizes, and then you save and continue, and that will take you to your deployments. Yeah, so that's the overall platform. It's pretty much all I had, but when it comes to dynamic capabilities, we do have feeds, so you have the ability to add all the different feeds. And now let me show you some of the wild stuff that we've done. And our partners have done. So just start with this one. This was done with these clothes were all taken in by a feed built by a partner. And as you can see, completely fluid. And so having the clothes there, this is the Macy's example, and you can actually click and drag and drop, and it will dynamically link. Another example is something that LG did, where instead of just showing a TV screen, that's just a TV screen, really to show how it's the best picture. So the designers that created this actually embedded in a beautiful widget, and this is completely fluid, and then works beautifully on all devices. So 3D animation, all that supported, and then as you can see, this closes down to a programmatic stretch format. Here's another one with dynamic carousel. Another one, a skin. The unique thing about skins is that when it gets to a certain level, you can even have it snap. So you can create formats that it exists cross-screen where it becomes an adhesion. So anything that you want to do where the ad jumps, we're doing a lot of there's been a lot of transparency. And right now, because it's all the different sizes are all contained within the same creative, we have what's called one of our kind of proprietary things is a sequential narrative. So all the creatives can talk to each other. So as one dynamically changes, the other one could be affected as well. So when we start thinking of cross-screen attribution and sequencing of retargeting, all those, they're all connected to the same creative. So it becomes very powerful as a design platform. To having the most powerful way to create great storytelling. Just another one with animation. So the GreenSock libraries. I didn't show the developer console or the embedded GreenSock libraries, but any libraries can be embedded, and this was done by a GreenSock developer. There you go. Yeah. So thank you very much. And here's, I'll put up the slide again if you want to reach out to us. So feel free to reach out and check out our gallery and our free sign up, responsiveads.com/IAB. So we love the IAB.
Thank you. Thanks everyone for coming, and thanks Matthew, thanks Sam, thanks Nivesh. And thanks, Katie, for all the great presentations. Very informative. Interestingly, like, we are building the new ad portfolio around flexible ads, and a lot of people ask, like, how are you going to do it? But looking at these demos today, I think it's all already being done. That was big takeaway for me. Like, a lot of the platforms already doing responsive cross-device and that's great to see and hear.